From protecting troops to securing the internet, cryptography is the basis of data security, but, as RSA Conference attendees might recall, it could have ended up very differently. The industry-leading conference is attended by over 40,000 people annually, though most are unaware that it initially came about as a Hail Mary pass by a team of researchers who had spent years refining their cryptographic toolkit and suddenly found themselves facing an existential threat. That was the Clipper chip, a specialized microchip developed by the US National Security Agency to force companies into embedding encryption in their devices that could be cracked by authorities if needed to access terrorist or other critical communications. The cryptography community, once fragmented, began to see the need for a more integrated, trusted, and open field. Their answer came in the form of the first RSA conference, launched by Jim Bidzos in 1991. Guest speakers included Peter Newman and Bert Kalisky Jr., asymmetric key cryptography pioneers Whitfield Diffie and Martin Hellman, and of course, Ron Rivest, Adi Shamir, and Leonard Adelman, who invented the public key encryption technology of the same name that started it all in 1982.
The first conference was literally an immediate and direct result of sort of feeling a bit overwhelmed and unable to react to what was a massive sort of challenge to what we had done by trying to bring this debate out into the open.
This innovation marked a crucial step in adapting cryptography for the internet age, but as we widen the lens, it becomes clear this was only the latest chapter in a centuries-old history of cryptography.
Cryptography is a really old tool. This goes back at least 500 BC, and we certainly have evidence of Caesar and his armies using cryptography around 100 BC.
Prior to the modern age, cryptography was synonymous with encryption, the process of converting readable information into an unreadable form using a secret method. As a result, text could only then be understood by someone possessing the necessary decryption technique, which was typically shared only with authorized recipients. Over time, though, cryptography has become increasingly complex, with the development of rotor cipher machines in World War I and the advent of computers in World War II playing a pivotal role in pushing the boundaries of the technology.
Cryptography evolved a lot, especially during the Middle Ages, where it was a primary tool for diplomats, for instance, to communicate. It was used to carry confidential political messages.
In the immediate post-World War II period, the market for cryptography was almost entirely military. This meant that when the Cold War began and the US tightened controls on Western technology, it was classified as a weapon of war and subject to strict export regulations. This made sense at the time, considering encryption's crucial role in securing sensitive military communications. By the 1960s, however, financial organizations were beginning to require strong commercial encryption for the rapidly growing field of wired money transfers. The US government's introduction of the data encryption standard in 1975 meant that commercial uses of high-quality encryption would become common, and serious problems of export control began to arise.
It was a time where there were mounting government pressure towards standardizing certain cryptographic algorithms, and there were pressure towards making cryptography and encryption in particular harder to obtain by citizens. The importance of the RSA conference is precisely around that, to get people to be aware, to design alternatives to the standards put forth by the government.
The name RSA refers to the public key encryption technology developed by RSA Data Security Incorporated. The idea for the RSA conference, however, came about over a 1991 phone call between Bidzos, CEO of RSA Security at the time, and the executive director of the Electronic Privacy Information Center.
The Hotel Sofitel Redwood Shores, California was less than half a mile from our office. I called my marketing guy and I said, book the ballroom at the Sofitel for next week. I'm going to have a conference. I wanted to get this discussion and this debate out in the open. I wanted to drag it out where everybody could see and hear what I knew were all the various sides of it.
The plan worked, hastened by the demise of the Clipper chip, which ultimately faded into obscurity after being proven insecure in 1997. Over the next several decades, support for the RSA conference grew, transforming from a core attendance of what was 50 or 60 cryptographers into a regular forum for the cybersecurity community as a whole to meet and collaborate. The need for secure communication and data encryption has become a constant public concern, particularly following the widespread adoption of personal computers. In 1991, Bill Zimmermann's PGP cryptosystem and its distribution on the internet became the first major individual-level challenge to controls on the export of cryptography.
What was very unique and very revolutionary about PGP is that it was, for the first time, very easy to use compared to everything that came before. Everybody could encrypt their emails, everybody could encrypt their files, and could do it in a way that was actually secure.
The first widely available program implementing public key cryptography, PGP, quickly was in hot water, and after a report from RSA Security, the US Customs Service began criminally investigating Zimmermann. At the time, the US government had long regarded cryptographic software as a munition, and thus subject to arms trafficking export controls. The investigation lasted 3 years, but was ultimately dropped after the code for PGP became public.
A modern way to look at PGP is to look at it as an end-to-end encryption tool. Now we're all familiar with WhatsApp and Signal on smartphones. Telegram will certainly be one example of an early software for smartphone that allows end-to-end encryption, but I don't know if it's the first one.
The rise of cryptography, which is now woven into everyday activities such as secure messaging, online banking, and Wi-Fi connectivity, has given rise to new legal questions. At the center of this is a potential conflict between laws granting investigators access to encrypted data and the protection of individual privacy rights. The complexity of this issue was exemplified in the aftermath of a 2015 mass shooting in San Bernardino, California.
There was a terrorist attack, and the terrorist had an iPhone that was locked, and law enforcement asked Apple to unlock the device. And there was a lot of pressure there for Apple to develop a modified version of their operating system, install it on the phone, and this modified version would allow the FBI to unlock the phone, which is critical because iPhones are designed to allow users to delete the content of their phone if the passcode is entered incorrectly a certain number of times. Apple refused to do it, claiming that once the software exists, that puts at risk every user, not just that particular device. The FBI sued Apple for that, but eventually they dropped the lawsuit when they figured out that there were other ways to get into the phone.
Despite the resolution of this particular case, government access to secure devices remains a hotly debated topic among security experts, fueling an ongoing push for stronger encryption. Though how it will play out among today's tech giants remains to be seen. In today's digital landscape, it's hard to tell what the future of cryptography will look like, but it's likely to be impacted by several factors, one of which is the development of quantum computing.
The idea of a quantum computer is that it can solve certain problems that are very hard for traditional computers. What would take you billions of years on a regular computer might take maybe minutes or even less on a quantum computer. This has a big impact on cryptography. Public key encryption schemes that we're using today, for instance, are based on certain assumptions that are true in terms of complexity for regular computers, but not for quantum computers. Now, the worst of quantum computers could break RSA and a lot of other schemes that we use every day, which is concerning because even though quantum computers do not exist today, we believe that one day they will exist. And at that point, whoever was able to record encrypted communication today that we cannot decrypt will be able to decrypt it at that time.
In response, nations across the globe are racing and effectively competing with each other to develop quantum-resistant cryptographic algorithms to prepare for what experts are calling Q-Day, when current encryption will be vulnerable to quantum computing attacks.
The good news is that NIST very recently formalized post-quantum schemes that are believed to be secure against current and future attacks, so we're doing reasonably well there. The challenge is that these schemes are very new and are based on assumptions that are very, very new.
As technology continues to evolve, so too must cryptography. Without robust encryption, our connected world faces a staggering $10.5 trillion annual cost from cybercrime by 2025, according to Cybersecurity Ventures. Safeguarding the digital future starts with securing our defenses now. This production was brought to you by Keyless Technologies, which offers strong, privacy-focused passwordless authentication that dramatically reduces ATO fraud whilst improving the user experience for customers in the workforce. To learn more about our sponsor, visit keyless.io. For more on cryptography, visit our website at cybersecurityventures.com.